to go aboard the Titanic. My father went to the office and registered the name who were going on the boat. And we were very happy.
Life symbol of achievement for an era and the end of that era. Forever remembered for the bright arrogance of her promise and the spectacular finality of her failure. In the beginning, entrepreneurs of two great nations joined to create her, to show the world what knowledge, technology, and audacity can do. And in the end, her fate showed instead the folly of underestimating the forces of nature. And as an example then and now of the penalty excessive pride can pay. She carried the very rich, representatives of some of the largest personal fortunes on both sides of the Atlantic. And she carried, in much larger number, the very poor and their expectations of a better life in America. She carried both with a cold and certain equality to the bottom of the sea as the era of unfettered riches and almost unchecked immigration sank with her. She is remembered as a tragic luxury liner, but her first-class passengers were only 15% of those on board, and she was also commissioned and named for the mail and cargo she carried, as well as the people. She was the Royal Mail steamship Titanic, and in the next hour or so, you and I will explore both the majesty and the tragedy of her single and singular voyage into history and into the very psyche of the 20th century. Titanic, the exhibition, begins here as we see her name on an actual size recreation of a 90-foot section of the bow. It was on the starboard bow, 16 feet above the keel, that she would strike an iceberg and ripped the fatal tears in her side along a section 300 feet long. Above, we see a full-scale model of a huge propeller, 16 feet in diameter, only one of three that would move the Titanic through the water. And this was the baby of the three, mounted in the center. The two outside propellers were 24 feet in diameter. Note the number 401 stamped on the shaft, the code number for parts for the Titanic at the Harland & Wolff shipyard in Belfast, where she was built. That job began in 1909, and it took 3,000 men more than 2 years to complete. In fact, when she eased into the River Lagan in Belfast on May 31st, 1911, the Titanic was the largest moving object ever built by man. The first gallery introduces us to the owners of the Titanic, the White Star Line. And here we see a poster depicting the Oceanic, the White Star's first giant ocean liner. But the true giant was yet to sail. The White Star Line was bought by the famous American financier J. Pierpont Morgan in 1902. His intent was to compete with and overtake the leading steamship companies of the day, such as the Cunard Line, in the contest for transatlantic passenger trade. The first ships to take on that challenge were the Titanic and her sister ship, the Olympic. Morgan chose J. Bruce Ismay son of the White Star founder, to run the line, and Lord William J. Perry, director of Harland and Wolff, would build the flagship of the line. Indeed, the flagship of the world. Only Ismay would be a passenger on the maiden crossing. All of the items in this case are from the Titanic, but none bear the name. Each flies a distinctive swallow-tailed flag, called a bourgee, with a star at its center. This is the White Star logo. These items could have been used on any of the line's ships. History would use them on only one. This is the Titanic as she looked brand new, dockside at Harland and Wolff. 882.5 feet. Four city blocks long. 92.5 feet broad and 7 stories high, without her 4 stacks. The 4th added for appearance alone. She weighed 66,000 tons, and each of her 3 engines was the size of a 3-story house. It took 20 draft horses to haul one of her massive anchors through the streets of Belfast. As we study the minute detail of this 18-foot scale model, remember the section of bow you saw as we entered the exhibition. Compare that to a corresponding section here on the starboard bow of the model. Get a sense of the immense size of the Titanic. This is a bearing from one of her engines. Just a bearing, and it weighs almost 5,000 pounds. Next to it are huge chunks of coal. The ship carried 6,000 tons of it, enough for the 650 tons a day she would need for her 6-day crossing. Now let's count the lifeboats. 8 on each side, 16 in all. 20 on board, counting 4 collapsibles. The original designer called for 64 lifeboats and then reduced the number to 32. To make more room and a better view on the first-class promenade, Ismay fitted the Titanic with just the 16. Lifeboat capacity, 1,200. Ship capacity, 3,000. On board for the maiden voyage, 2,228. Saved in boats, 705. This cutaway diagram may offer some explanation for such an astounding assumption that more lifeboats would not be needed. The bottom of the ship is lined with compartments, and each one can be instantaneously sealed by huge, watertight doors controlled by the bridge. Even if water enters the first compartment, how could it possibly reach the second? Or how ridiculous the third or the fourth? How could the ship possibly be in peril when the designers said she would stay afloat even if all 4 of the first compartments flood? How indeed? The map here shows us her planned route. From Southampton, England, to Cherbourg in France, where this luxurious tender, the Nomadique, would ferry passengers out to her in the harbor. The water next to the pier was too shallow for the Titanic. The Nomadique is now a floating restaurant on the Seine in Paris. From Cherbourg, she would steam to Queenston in Ireland to pick up more passengers, and then across the North Atlantic on a course for New York. A course no one else would follow for years, out of respect and fear for the one that did. Here at the top is the tip of Greenland. And at the time of the Titanic's crossing, due to an unusually warm winter in 1912, Greenland's glaciers have released a large number of icebergs, many floating south into the shipping lanes. Even with the warning, trusting in her lookouts and in her design, many feel the Titanic will set a new Atlantic crossing record, full steam ahead. Now it's April 10th, 1912, in Southampton. The gigantic steam whistle on one of the ship's 4 stacks announces we are preparing to depart, shown here on the model, and here, in reality, as we enter the next gallery. The Titanic steam whistles, for the largest ever made. We see our fellow passengers, all ages, all walks of life. The excitement at being part of this great adventure aboard the greatest ship ever built is contagious. We also see about us, as we approach the gangway, evidence of the crew that will serve us and the luggage and baggage of the period. Of the 2,228 aboard, 908 are crew. Here is a trunk that belonged to the third officer, but for reasons unknown, it didn't make the voyage. Here is a wrench. Here is a ladle. And a few of the hundreds of ordinary pots and pans the ship's galley crew would use to prepare our food. And a faucet that would rinse those pots and pans. Binoculars for the sharp lookout we all know was needed. All showing the eerie wear and tear of 8 decades, 2.5 miles beneath the sea. But yet, here is a steward's jacket, also recovered from the depths, and looking almost presentable. It still clearly shows, amazingly, a laundry mark bearing the steward's name, Broom.
Athol Broom at your service.
Ship's records show us that Athol Broom served in the Veranda Cafe in first class.
Please don't hesitate to call.
We will soon be at his station. Stewards took care of every little thing for the Titanic's passengers at their beck and call. Those assigned to the passenger quarters would usually care for only 8 or 9 staterooms. Step up on deck. Ahead is the Veranda Cafe, literally a first-class establishment. Just outside the cafe, we see a deck chair to relax in as we take the sea air, and a bench on deck for the Titanic sea trials. And here are parts of the decorative metal arches from the cafe windows. Now we'll move from the chilly deck into the warmth of first-class Edwardian elegance and the Veranda Cafe, one of 2 a la carte restaurants in first class. The other was the Café Parisien. The floor is linoleum, and in 1912, that was very much a first-class modern innovation. In this case, much of it designed for the White Star Line is the kind of silver service, sterling and vermeil, that would have been the standard in the Veranda. This splendid gold-trimmed blue and white Copeland Spode china pattern was created for the White Star. This simple floral pattern, probably Irish in origin, was not among the ship's stores, but rather private property, either brought on board by an unidentified passenger or part of the ship's cargo bound for America. To whet the collective whistle, the Titanic carried 20,000 bottles of beer and stout alone, and no telling how many cases of champagne, including these 2 bottles, still corked, vintage 1880, perhaps served here in the Veranda to someone discerning, or at least well-heeled. Here is a check from one of the restaurants, and quite possibly some of the fare. The price of passage included all meals in the 3 dining areas, first, second, and third class. But the 2 restaurants allowed the first class to further indulge themselves. And, of course, to pay for the privilege.
Thank you.
This large crop was full of olives. Life below the sea has long since removed the olives, but did leave us the pits. This bottle still has its cork seal and all of its olives. It is the evening now of April 14th, 1912. As we leave the Veranda Cafe and enter the first class reception room, and a time remembered but gone. It is the Gilded Age, and everyone you see here would be shining. It is an era of privilege, some earned, some given, some inherited, and all elaborately displayed. Formal attire was required at dinner each evening, and As conversation and music from the orchestra in the dining room would mix, passengers would mingle here, compliment and admire each other's ensembles, and to comment on those climbing the grand staircase and the social ladder. This gilded chandelier hung above the grand staircase. There, as we see in the photograph, and here in the actual chandelier, we can still see fragments of the original bulbs. Above it is the iron grill from a first-class stateroom heating return. Even the design on something as basic as this is elaborate. This case holds examples of the gold, diamonds, and sapphires those gathered here wore each and every evening aboard, including this, the last. The original owner of this bracelet, with Amy brilliantly written in diamond script, has never been determined. Of the three Amys on the passenger list, surely one wore this for a trip or two down the grand staircase. Here in the middle in a case, and there behind in the photograph, is a cherub. The cherub held a lamp and lit a privileged world. The photograph, you see, is of the forward grand staircase and its cherub lamp. There is also a somewhat smaller, but identical in style, staircase aft. The cherub in the case is the one from that staircase. As the evening of April 14th draws on, dinner and dancing drawing to a close, we move with the passengers to the next stage. Before retiring to their staterooms for the night, some of the gentlemen would enjoy some of the comforts of one of the smoking lounges. No ladies allowed. While some of the ladies would meet in one of the drawing rooms, perhaps the gentlemen would indulge in a little Benedictine from this bottle, a pool from this flask, a game of cards, a cigarette or a pipe. Consider that these cigarettes, this bowl of tobacco, survived some 80 years under the Atlantic. They might, although since they are gentlemen, it is highly unlikely, loosen one of these ties. These classic lines, timeless design, and White Star logo would only belong to one of the gentlemen's standbys, the spittoon. Along the walls, we are afforded a glimpse of what life was like for the first-class traveler on board. Turkish baths, a gymnasium, and, of course, ahead of its time, even a swimming pool. In the staterooms, passengers prepare for what they believe will be an uneventful, restful night, and spread before them are their toiletry items. Combs and hairbrushes, mirrors, toothbrushes and tonics, shoe polish and cold cream. Here a shaving soap stick that, even after all this time, still has the distinctive smell of shaving soap. A lavatory sink from first class, note the proud insignia of the maker, and a sink from second class, with a companion chamber pot. This silver lamp is a pendulum lamp, designed to stay upright as the ocean moves the ship from side to side. This was important so that the fuel necessary to light the lamp wouldn't spill, or that a candle inside wouldn't fall. Interesting, since this was an electric lamp and none of that was necessary, even in the most modern of vessels, a bow to older ship design. Tonight, the lamp would move very little as the sea is calm beneath a clear but moonless night sky. As we move into the next gallery, we step onto the bridge of the RMS Titanic. It is 10 p.m. on April 14th. Captain Edward J. Smith and Second Officer Lightoller retire for the evening. Lightoller turns the watch over to First Officer W.M. Murdoch. Out in front of the bridge, over the crow's nest on the ship's foremast, is this navigation lamp. Seen from quite a distance, the lamp serves as a mark and warning to others of the Titanic's position and approach. Only the ice is out there to see it. Beneath the beacon, also coming on duty at 10 p.m. and stationed as lookouts, are seamen Frederick Fleet and Reginald Lee. Warned to look for ice, they see something hazy but massive altering the night. Fleet gives the warning bell three sharp rings, meaning object dead ahead, and calls the bridge. Iceberg right ahead! Murdoch sees the iceberg as well and yanks the arm on the engine telegraph, connected directly to the engine room in the bowels of the great ship. This is the engine telegraph from the aft bridge of the Titanic. Murdoch sent his urgent command. Hard to starboard, full speed astern! The ship's wheel, mounted on a column like this one from the aft bridge, is immediately spun hard to starboard by Quartermaster Robert Hitchens. It is 11:40 p.m., April 14th, 1912. While a head-on collision is avoided, the ship's starboard bow strikes the ice, and in only 10 agonizing and fatal seconds, a series of holes are punched in her side over the length of a football field. Even the watertight doors are no match for the iceberg's rain. Water rushes into 5 of the 16 watertight compartments, into the forepeak, holds, and boiler rooms. The unsinkable Titanic is going to sink. Amidships, far back of the collision, in first class, few are aware that anything has happened. Fewer still feel only a tremor to arouse their curiosity. Some passengers would actually see the great gray mountain of ice off to starboard and be amused and intrigued by the pieces and shavings of ice on deck. Captain Smith, now very much awake, rushes to the bridge and then to the Marconi room to order the wireless operators to send out distress signals. The closest ship, the Californian, has shut down her radio for the night. The next closest, the Carpathia, is 58 miles away and begins steaming for the Titanic. As passengers notice that engines have stopped and begin to ask questions, the crew assures them that damage is minimal and that there is no cause for alarm. Captain Smith consults with ship designer Thomas Andrews, who informs the captain that the ship has but an hour and a half left, possibly two. It is now 12:25 a.m., April 15th, and the order has been passed to load the lifeboats. A few minutes later, distress signal rockets are fired from the bridge rail. On the port side, only women and children are allowed to board the lifeboats, but on the starboard, some men are permitted to board. Among them, head of the White Star Line, J. Bruce Ismay, who boards the last boat lowered on the starboard side, a collapsible, wearing a suit over his pajamas and carpet slippers. By 2 a.m., all boats except collapsible boat B on top of the officers' quarters are away. 16 lifeboats and 3 of the 4 collapsibles are now in the water. With a capacity of 1,200, only 705 board the boats and 2 docks. Only 705 from a total on board the Titanic of 2,228. The boat's away. We walk now into the next gallery, toward the starboard rail. And a night sky, so clear, so full of stars, survivors call it the most brilliant they have ever seen. And toward the empty falls that once held the lifeboats. The star formations you see here in the exhibition are in the same position as the passengers and crew viewed them from this rail that night. This is a Fosbury life jacket from the Titanic, made from canvas and cork. Some left on board would put these on. Others would accept their fate, knowing that a life jacket would be of little use beyond a few minutes floating in the frigid waters of the North Atlantic. In fact, the person who wore this one did not survive those waters. Some would accept that fate in truly and unbelievably grand style. Industrialist Benjamin Guggenheim and his manservant Victor Giglio would leave the boat deck and return to their cabins. There they changed into evening wear and prepared to, quote, go down like gentlemen. Bandmaster Wallace Hartley leads his band throughout, lifting spirits and playing everything from ragtime to hymns, even as the ship is disappearing. All perish with her. Some survivors remember their last song to be the hymn Autumn, others, Nearer My God to Thee. Colonel John Jacob Astor, heir to one of the world's great fortunes and one of the most powerful men of the time, would see his new young wife safely aboard one of the lifeboats and then step quietly back onto the deck and into memory as the boat is lowered. Isidore Strauss, owner of Macy's, and his wife Ida Strauss stand side by side on deck. As she is urged to board a boat, she replies, "No, I will not be separated from my husband. As we have lived, so will we die, together." Mr. Strauss is then invited to join his wife in the boat, and he replies, "No, I do not wish any distinction in my favor, which is not granted to others." The couple then put Mrs. Strauss's maid, Ellen Bird, into a boat and go below to wait. Not all will go with such dignity, struggling toward the rails and the lowering boats. Gunshots are fired into the air as a warning. The crew is ordered to lock arms and form a circle around the deck. Through a megaphone, perhaps this one, passengers are instructed to stand back, women and children first. Only women and children will be allowed past that circle. Second-class passenger, Mikhail Navratil, hands his two sons, Edmund II and Mikhail, almost four, through the circle. In a failing marriage, he kidnapped them from their mother to take them to America. He now saves their lives and loses his own. Captain Smith returns to the bridge, telling crew in passing, "It's every man for himself." He will go down with his last command. As the portholes slip beneath the surface and the stern rises into the night, hundreds slip into the sea. The collapsible boat B is thrown into the water upside down. Many swim frantically for it. Many of those are crushed as the gigantic forward funnel breaks its stay and crashes into the water, its wash pushing collapsible B even further away. Those in the boats, many taking on water and fearful of swamping, could help relatively few of those in the dark sea. Amid their screams, the sad spectacle is mercifully soon completed. The unsinkable Titanic, the largest moving object ever built by man, and 1,523 of her crew and passengers are gone. It is 2:20 3:20 a.m., April 15th, 1912. The Carpathia is steaming to help, but nowhere in sight, as the stunned survivors shiver in the boats, many knee-deep in numbing water, with no assurance of anything more.
When they were rowing out, the boat was leaking. My mother had high boots on at that time, and the water came up to her calves, but they started to boil out, and it just stayed where it was. It didn't get any deeper, and it didn't go down very much. And they all huddled together in the lifeboat. My mother never had a coat. Somebody put their fur coat round her.
Step now into the next gallery, as we look at a photograph of what most believe, due to its position, to be the iceberg the Titanic struck. It was taken by the captain of another ship 2 days before the disaster. His signature is on the photo. Captain Woods of the SS Estonia. We now turn to a large mural of the Carpathia as she rescues the Titanic survivors. She arrived as dawn was breaking, about 4 a.m., and by 8 that morning had all 705 aboard. Look now at the world's reaction and initial confusion while the Carpathia heads for port in New York. The tragedy is reported. Titanic disaster, great loss of life, and misreported, all saved from Titanic after collision. Even the White Star Line refuses to believe such a thing could even be possible. The vice president tells reporters, "We believe the ship to be unsinkable." But sink she did. And the tragic truth was soon known. Hearings were held and survivors interviewed on both sides of the Atlantic to determine not only what happened, but how such a disaster could be avoided in future. Recommendations from those hearings included requiring enough lifeboats for all passengers and crew, regular lifeboat drills, and 24-hour radio watches. 4 days after the rescue, a fleet of ships heads out from Nova Scotia to search for and return bodies. They found only 330. And, unable to avoid the temptation of souvenirs, some of the crew collect driftwood from the wreck of the great ship. One of those crew members made this chess table from that driftwood, and this picture frame. Those crew members were not alone then or today in their fascination and curiosity concerning the facts and, more appropriately, the myths and legends of the Titanic tragedy. Myths and legends in records and books, translated into a world of languages. And certainly myths and legends in movie after movie. The first of them, saved from the Titanic, was released just 4 weeks after she went down. Filmed in New Jersey, it starred actress Dorothy Gibson, an actual survivor whose movie wardrobe included what she was wearing when she left the Titanic. But here then is a scale model of reality, the wreck of the forward half of the Titanic. She sits 2.5 miles below the surface of the North Atlantic. The wreck of her stern, even more mangled, lies some 1,900 feet away. A field of ship's debris connects them and us to the truth and reality of her loss. A time called the Gilded Age ended in rust right here, with the largest and most dramatic symbol of the age lost to all. That she broke in half when she sank was not known for sure. Where she lay exactly was not known for sure. Until 1 a.m. September 1st, 1985, when a joint US-French expedition, led by Woods Hole oceanographer Bob Ballard, spots her after a 56-day sonar search over a grid of possible locations. All other searches, and there were many, had failed until this one. And Ballard recalls how, after a brief celebration, the crew became aware of the somber reality of where they were, exactly where those 1,523 were lost. A service in their memory was held on the fantail of the expedition ship. This is a scale model of the 26-foot deep-sea submersible Nautile. The Nautile is one of the very few manned submersibles ever built, capable of exploring the ocean floor at the 2.5-mile depth of the Titanic. She is owned by a French oceanographic institute working in partnership with RMS Titanic Incorporated of New York, the organization that holds salvage rights to the wreck. The orchestrated efforts of the Nautile's robotic arms, claws, and suction cups can retrieve even the most fragile of items. A restaurant check from the Veranda Cafe to things weighing tons, a 2-plus-ton bearing, or this huge bollard from the Titanic deck. She recovered most of the artifacts seen here in the exhibition, and over 4,000 have been recovered from the Titanic's debris field since 1987. Time is of the essence, since the years continue to take their toll, and the rust, microbes, mollusks, and other deep-sea conditions continue to take their due. Sooner than later, all will be lost to the sea. Out of sensitivity to the emotions involved and respect for the site, RMS Titanic Incorporated will leave the main wreckage of the Titanic undisturbed. Only artifacts from the debris field will be collected for the purposes of archaeological study. Here, Seymour en Ossoise in France, the painstaking process of restoration of the Titanic's artifacts takes its careful, ordered time in the restoration workrooms of LP3. The amazing results of that process are readily apparent throughout this exhibition.
Right. The first treatment have been done. It's a freeze drying in order to be able to separate each postcard separately. But after, there's a lot of work to do to fix the printing on the postcard, and being also able to make them flat. So we'll have to do a lot of more treatment on the postcard. It's very difficult to handling, so I won't open it now. The paper are very fragile. It's not the same kind of paper than books. It's more thicker. It's like cardboard.
We now move into the final gallery. The Titanic in Memoriam. A memorial in Belfast, the city of the Titanic's birth. Southampton, a city that lost 549 of her own in the tragedy. The monument to bandmaster Wallace Hartley and his 8 valiant musicians, also in Southampton. The grave graveyard in Halifax, Nova Scotia. The 330 found at the wreck site some 1,000 miles east found their final rest here. From memorial plaques from churches all over the British Isles. Remembers the Titanic, not just because her loss was recent, but because it was timeless. Man against the forces of nature, confident that this time, intellect and technology will assure our victory. And when that confidence replaces respect and perspective, we are, every time, destined to lose. The lesson taught us by this tragedy still resonates from 2.5 miles down.
Really, it's the ultimate symbol of disaster and appeals right across the cultural spectrum, from high culture to low culture, high culture to consumer culture. It appeals very much to the popular imagination and for a whole variety of reasons, but also appeals to artists and writers. And the Titanic and its story has been refracted through their imagination. But it goes, it as you say, it engages with popular culture as well, and ordinary folks are just so absorbed by it. It's if you like, I think, a parable of the 20th century. It's about the enduring relationship between man, machine, and implacable nature. It's about human fallibility and nobility in disastrous circumstances. It's the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century as well.
As the once beautiful liner continues to deteriorate, the artifacts seen in this exhibition will assume a new significance. One day they will be the final tangible link to history's most famous ship, and to her passengers and crew, whose memory they honor. Thank you. Wonders has sought to promote awareness of and education in the world's diverse cultures by displaying actual objects reflecting individuals and events that have had a significant impact on human history. As one sage put it, it is Wonders' mission to guard their memory and tell their tale. Wonders is honored to have been selected by RMS Titanic, Inc. to develop an exhibition that will ensure that Titanic, its survivors, and those who are lost are never forgotten. It is Wonders' desire to present the Titanic story in a historically accurate and reverent manner, and to promote further study and research into this influential event.